Hello. In this video, what I want to talk about and us for us to think through is the passion of Jesus and the account in the Gospels of the conversation between the robbers and Jesus. And one of the things that I've been now I'm puzzling over, it doesn't make sense to me. The robbers say to Jesus, like, we deserve to die, we've done wrong, but obviously you don't deserve to die, you're a good man. That's the gist of it. So robbers saying we deserve to die by crucifixion. There are a number of things about this account that don't, to me don't make sense. The first thing you have to get is when you're crucified, you are high up in the air. I did research into the crucifixion decades ago, so I'm just telling you what I remember to give you the feel of their physical state of the of how they would be in. Jesus would have been absolutely exhausted by the time he arrived at the cross, because we do know from the Gospels it says he had to carry a heavy boulder and he couldn't manage that and he needed help. Somebody had to come and help him. He was absolutely wiped out and exhausted from trying to carry that boulder. He had been whipped and scourged beforehand, held in prison, probably not given enough water, enough food. He would have been depleted of energy and strength, and he was absolutely wiped out and hot and sweating from trying to carry that boulder. So there he is, he's now upon the cross, and it's boiling hot up there because the sun is directly in their faces, not only in the face of Jesus but the two robbers. So the sun is directly in the face. Can you imagine what it's like on a hot day when you look up in the air and that sun is beating down on your face? You have to look away, don't you? You have to look away. And it's just they're just sweltering from the heat. They are in the most incredible pain, all three of them. All three of them will have pounding headaches. Pounding, the heads will be pounding. Their arms, you try holding your arm out for half an hour extended, and it's excruciatingly painful. Their thighs and the lower legs would be an excruciating pain. Not discounting the feet, and the hands, which just can't envisage that, the degree of pain. They would have been sweating and sweating. Their chest will be constricted from the position that they're in, so they would have probably difficulties breathing. They would be struggling, and in fact, cause of death by crucifixion is heart failure. Cause of death when a person is crucified is always heart failure. The heart can't stand it. The heart can't stand it. I can't ex remember all the minutiae of what happens in causing the heart to fail. But you can research this on Google. It's because when I did my research, there was no internet. But you can do it now and you can research it. It's very, very interesting to do and to understand exactly what's happening to the body when a person is being crucified. And you have to remember that was the Romans' way of trying to deal with crime, right? Stop crime. Now, it just shows you how bad crime was, and the Romans were struggling to maintain supremacy of control in the land, because these are robbers that are crucified on either side of Jesus. They're not, it's not Hannibal Lecter, it's not Ted Bundy. These are not serial killers. These are, no, they're not murderers, they're not paedophiles, these are robbers. Now they're saying to Jesus, to get back to the original point, we deserve to die. Well, I don't believe that. I don't believe they said it. You know why? You ask any prisoner who has committed any robbery, robbing a bank, robbing Walmart, robbing Asda, there in Jerusalem, robbing Asda, robbing a Santander bank, robbing anything. You ask any prisoner in any prison in the whole wide world and you will not find one single prisoner who says, I deserve to die by crucifixion because I robbed Walmart. I tried to steal the crown jewels or something. This is absolutely ridiculous. If you ask any prison officer this, can you imagine any prisoner convicted of robbery, of saying, I deserve to die by crucifixion, and they would just laugh in your face. This is absolutely ridiculous. Now, it is true that certain murderers, a few murderers, do say when they're on death row, I deserve to die. What I've done is terrible and I do deserve to die. Some actually are wanting to die. They're trying to step it up and I want to die. You know, kill me now. But this is only in a minority. But the point is, these were robbers, right? Robbers don't have any conscience. That's the whole point of being a robber, right? These are people who, you know, people are breaking into homes and robbing you of all your possessions, of your jewellery, of your late mother, of your late husband, things that mean to you. They don't give a toss about what it means to you. They're quite selfish. And I remember an ex-robber being interviewed and he said, robbers are quite selfish. They don't care about how their crime affects people, right? They just go into places and they take what they want and they don't care about the impact it has on that person's life. They don't think about it, right? And even if a robber had slight remorse, no robber on the planet would say that they deserve to die because of the robbery or to die from crucifixion, right? Remember, these robbers would have probably been Jewish, right, I presume. They would know all about repentance. They would know all about repentance. They would know that what Judaism is about is to stop doing what you're doing and ask for God's forgiveness. And it's like you can start again and have a fresh life. The concept within Judaism of I've done something wrong and therefore I deserve to die, you know, whether it's robbing a bank or anything, is just ridiculous. This is ridiculous. This is not murder. You know, they haven't committed murder. They haven't taken the lives of children. Nothing like that. These are robbers. And this does not make sense to me, bearing in mind real life, because real life robbers don't think any robber would think they are worthy of death. They perhaps would admit that what they're doing is wrong, you know, if they develop a conscience about what they've done, you know, when they get older and they've been in prison and they're getting into the 40s and 50s and they start thinking, yes, it was, you know, I was stupid what I did when I was a young man and this, that, the other, right? So they could develop some remorse. But they wouldn't be thinking to themselves, I deserve to die because I robbed a bank. I robbed Walmart and Jerusalem. You know, I held up people hostage, you know, here, there and everywhere to get all their money and jewels. No, robbers don't think like that. They don't think like that. So these very words don't make sense. It doesn't tie up with reality of how people who rob think. Even if they did have remorse and were genuinely struck with repentance, you know, feeling bad about what they did, they wouldn't be saying or thinking to themselves, I deserve to die, and especially not by crucifixion. It's the worst possible death. Who would think they are worthy of dying? It's like saying, I'm guilty, I'm worthy of being hung, I'm worthy of going into the gas chamber. I'm worthy of being electrocuted, of going in the electric chair. No robber's going to say that. No robber's going to say that, because even they have the common sense to realise that robbery and the punishment, inverted commas, of killing them is ridiculous. It's totally extreme, it's over the top. And that actually indicates to you how panicky Rome was. The fact that they were crucifying robbers, they were in a real state, they were obviously struggling to control rebellion, and they probably just said, right, anybody who's trouble, anybody who commits anything, crucify them, crucify them. So that the fact that we're crucified is an indication that Rome was struggling to maintain control. It might be they not have enough troops, you don't know, but there's all sorts of reasons for that. The second thing you have to bear in mind is all three of them were totally and completely exhausted. There they are, they're up in the air with the sun beating down. They are sweating profusely. Their head is pounding and they're in so much pain and they're so hot. You know, you're sweating with the pain. What happens is your mouth goes dry. By the time Jesus would have arrived, his mouth would have been totally dry. It would have been totally dry simply from trying to carry that boulder. He would have been so exhausted and his whole mouth and his throat, everything would have been dried out. Because this is what happens when you get exhausted. You need a drink of water, because he's not going to be given a drink of water before he's crucified. No, he's put upon the cross. And the other robbers would have been up there hot. And their mouths would have been dry. Their throats would have been dry. You have to remember, they wouldn't. Their heads would not be high up in the air. You know, they're not sort of holding their heads up, you know, like Hollywood. This is because of the degree of pain that they're in. And they are so weak, all three of them, heads would be bent right down. You would not have been able to hear anything either three of them said. You would not be able to hear it from the ground. You wouldn't. This is not Hollywood. There were no microphones. There were no microphones. They were so weak from being up there in this sweltering heat, of being in so much pain, of the dry mouth and the throat, everything's dried out from the heat, that they would be struggling to even whisper, right? Jesus would not have been able to cry out. He would not be able to have cried out at the end, "It is finished," or anything like this, or into your hands I commit my spirit, anything. This crying out business at the end before he dies is Hollywood. This is Hollywood. This is the writer of the Gospels telling a story, making it dramatic, giving some theatre to the story. He would not have been able to cry out. He would not have been able to lift his head up into heaven like you see on paintings or in depictions on television or the cinema. He would not have had the strength. All three of them, their faces would be down. They wouldn't have the strength to even lift the heads up. That's how weak they would have got. Right? And their mouths would be dry, and they would, because it was quite usual for people, relatives, to stand at the cross and to put a sponge wet with wine or something and to try and put it on the lips to give moisture, because they're totally dried out. I have a chronic fatigue syndrome, and I can be comatose in bed for 18 hours. And when I wake up, my mouth is so dry that if I pick up the phone after it's ringing, I can't speak. I can't speak. I'm just squeaking down the phone. I am so dry, I have to get a glass of water. So this, for their situation, it's going to be trebled and trebled, right? They're high up. Nobody will be able to hear what they're saying. They might see the mouth moving, but they wouldn't be able to even lip read, because they wouldn't be able to form words even. It would be simply struggling to whisper. So the very idea of a conversation taking place is ridiculous in my view. It doesn't make sense with the circumstances and with the actual how crucifixion affects people. They wouldn't be able to sort of have a little chat there up there on the cross. Well, they'd be, you know, the degree of pain is just unimaginable. Unimaginable. And they would be all dried out and they wouldn't probably be able to hear each other because their voices would be croaky and they'd be mumbling and you just wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be heard. And so I don't believe this account. What I think is the writer has to try and imagine what could have been said while Jesus was up on the cross with these two robbers, right? What conversation would have taken place if a conversation had taken place? In other words, what the writer is doing is trying to imagine a conversation taking place and what it would consist of. This is what writers do. They use their imagination. They use their imagination. They use their imagination. And those onlookers would not have been able to hear. If there was any conversation, they wouldn't be able to hear because the words just carry on the air. And they wouldn't be able to shout, at the top of their voice so everybody down below could hear them. They wouldn't have the strength to do that. It's only if, like, I've been so weak with my ME that I can hardly speak. My mouth is so dry, my throat is so dry, I am so weak from the pain and everything. I wake up and I can't speak, I can't even call for help. I remember once giving blood and there was a reaction, I don't know what happened. I was at a blood donor centre and I just felt I was dying. And I couldn't call for help. That's how weak I was. I could not call for help. And I knew something seriously wrong was happening. So the blood was coming out of me, and I was lying there and the nurses were all busy with other patients. And I felt I was dying and I couldn't call for help. There was no strength. All the strength went out of my body and I couldn't call for help. So I can sort of get this a little bit. And I don't believe for one moment that they're having a nice little chat up there. You deserve to die. I don't deserve to die. All this and that, the other. Also, there is no mention of any of these three people saying the Shema. Right? The dying, there's nothing, the gospel writer hasn't chosen to mention that they would have said the Shema. There's no mention of any, but nothing like that. But even then they probably wouldn't hear. But then perhaps they just say it in the mind and wouldn't be able to get the words out. To me, the words of Jesus like, well, it is finished, or into my soul, into you, I commit my spirit, all of this. Again, nobody would have been able to hear anything, nothing, whatever he said. And it's interesting how they get he's managing to complete sentences. He's managing to complete sentences. Whereas in reality, in a situation like that, you wouldn't be able to hear. And if you did, if you thought you heard something, you would not be sure. People would be saying, what did he say? Is he trying to speak? What's he saying? Nobody would. They'd see him, perhaps the lips moving, but they wouldn't know what he was saying. Is he saying this? Is he saying that? Now, the writer, 20 years after the death of Jesus, is going around trying to get people to give their account. Were you there? Were you there when Jesus was crucified? Were you there? Did you hear the robbers there? What happened? Well, you can't rely on the general public, because we all know everybody's looking for their 5 minutes of fame. It's no different then than it is now. Oh, I was there, And, you can imagine people coming up with all sorts of stories and, people recounting fake conversations, because that is the way some people are, as we know. And this is can be a real problem for the police all over the world. The police have a problem, and you know what the main problem is? When they're looking for witnesses, right, to very serious crimes, what they do is get inundated with people telling tall stories. They've inundated people making up stories, and it's trying to sift through these people to get the real witnesses, and it's a hell of a job for the police, and it wastes so much time trying to sort out who is telling the truth and who isn't. And so to me, this is all conjecture. It is the writer trying to imagine, what would Jesus say? What would the robbers say? And to me, it bears no relation to the reality of crucifixion, because if you research crucifixion, understand what's going on in the body and everything, the whole process, you realize this is so unlikely to have been said. Nobody would have been able to hear. There were no microphones. There were no microphones. You have to get this. They wouldn't have had the strength to lift up to heaven the heads, you know, like paintings. The problem is, we are surrounded with religious imagery by painters, you know, by poets. And we tend to think this is the truth. It's not the truth. It's the poet, it's the artiste using their imagination and perhaps trying to add something to the writing, to the imagery, to try and make it more dramatic. Right, and to try and engage the audience, you know, look at Jesus looking up to heaven, you know, in his last moments, beseeching to God. No, the reality is he wouldn't have had the strength to do that. And I know a lot of people will be very, very offended by all this that I'm saying, because it feels threatening to your very faith. But you do have to examine accounts like this and ask, how can this be true? Let's look at the reality. Let's look at the facts. Let's look at the facts. How could this have been? How could this have been? I hope this has given you something to think about.